Okay, hello everyone. It's time to start. My name is András Tímár, and I'm working with Collabora, who, first of all, is working on the cloud version of LibreOffice, Collabora Online, but also provides enterprise support for the desktop version of LibreOffice. And this topic is related to that, the central configuration management of LibreOffice in Windows Server environment. This topic is not completely new, but there were some progress in the last year, and probably it's the first time that someone will demonstrate it, how it works actually in practice. So the goal is to customize the persistent settings of LibreOffice, which can be many. So there are around 20,000 different settings. LibreOffice can remember almost anything from the position of the windows to the username, the recent document list, and so on. So we want to configure this software in a repeatable manner for large scale deployments. It's important that we don't have to do it on individual workstations. Somehow we need to manage it centrally. And it's also important to comply to a company policy. Probably the company can prescribe what is the default template path or what UI language could be used. So we need to lock down these settings so that the user cannot change them. So we can also disable features, for example, disable the advanced configuration panel if we want. We can set paths to the templates to a network share. We can prescribe the security settings, set the company name, and so on, set the default fonts. Whatever is configurable in LibreOffice, it's possible to manage centrally. So the LibreOffice configuration architecture was designed so that it's possible. So it has it can have several layers. Typically, we have three layers. One is the application layer, which contains the defaults. These are hardwired into the in the program files directory, so it comes with the installation. The second is an administrative layer, which we will want to configure, and it is read-only for normal users. And on the top of that, there is the user configuration layer. It's in the user profile, which is a read-write directory for the user. So when we have those layers, when we set something down below and then overwrite it on a higher layer, the highest layer wins always, unless we lock down the setting in a lower layer. So we need to talk about a bit the actual configuration backends, where these configurations are stored. So first of all, there are the XML files, because LibreOffice is a platform independent solution. So this is the main configuration backend that exists. These XML files are the same for all supported platforms. However, there are some system dependent backends which help the integration in a specific system, Windows, Linux, macOS. So, for example, the system locale is read from these system dependent backends, also the accessibility, and on some platforms, even the username. Recently, for Linux, the dconf backend was added, which helps the Linux administration. The Windows registry backend was added around 3 years ago. Obviously, it's only available on Windows. But it's quite important for the Windows administrators because usually Windows applications store their settings in Windows registry. So I was not sure about whether my talk will be in the developer session or the, this migration session. So I added some technical details to the slides, but we can skip them, of course. So this is where this the source file where this registry backend is implemented. It's quite short and it has a very simplistic approach. So we don't bother to parse the Windows registry, which is difficult. We just simply read the registry tree on startup, write to a temporary XML file to the disk, and let the config manager read it and include it into the configuration tree. So it, for this reason, we added another layer to the this between the administrative layer and the user layer in the configuration layers. It's handled in the fundamental.ini the window in the LibreOffice's installation directory. So it points to this solution and it activates this temporary file reading. And after we read and parse this temporary file, we delete it so the user will not notice anything. So it is, you can read from the slides that we put the register, we read the configuration values from a specific registry location. We read from the local machine and from the current user hives as well, and we read from these policies structure. And it's important because to this tree, we can write centrally with the group policy management tools. For example, for Windows, from Windows Server, we can create group policy objects for a specific group of computers or users and push those policies down to the computers or computer groups or user groups, and those settings will be applied for them when they log into the computer, and then when they start a LibreOffice, they will have the configured pre-configured settings. So it's a little bit tricky how to find the settings, what we need to write into the registry. So one option is to read the expert config page or change the setting on the UI and find the registry modifications and so on. And so it's not for the average user, but luckily, Collabora maintains a group policy administrative template, which contains around 100 important settings, and it can be extended, of course, anytime. So we added one or two more in the last weeks, and it can be downloaded and it can be used either for LibreOffice or for Collabora Office. It doesn't matter, it's all the same. So there is a link for this on the slide. Later you can download and check it. So I'd like to show two examples how this thing works. So I'd like to demonstrate that the registry backend actually works. The one is that we will set the company name to example corporation, and the second my second example is that we will hide the tools options LibreOffice advanced panel. So let's see how we do this. So when I start LibreOffice or Collabora Office in this case, we can see that the company name here is empty at the moment, and we have the advanced panel here. Okay, let's close LibreOffice and apply the registry settings. Okay, so I will show you these two files. It contains more or less the same that we had on the slides. So it's not, I'm not cheating. Okay, let's start Collabora Office again and see what happened. So we have the company name, which the user cannot modify very good. And we don't have the advanced panel here anymore. So we actively disable it, and the user cannot do nasty things in the corporate environment. Okay, but these registry keys are not very convenient to handle. So I want to show you the ADMX template as well, how to set up settings with that. So let me start the group policy editor. Here I can edit only the local policy. Obviously on Windows Server you can create group policies as well. So for example, here is the administrative template. Okay, I forgot to mention, first I copied the administrative template files into the 3/windows/policy-definitions and the language file to the ENUS directory. So I did it before the presentation. And now, for example, we can set say a security setting, for example, security warnings when creating PDF. Here I enable this policy and let's have this checkbox checked, and let's finalize this setting. I press OK. Then we see that the policy is enabled, and then I have to run. Oops, it's too small, I'm sorry. Somehow it's not expected, but I will run the gp update command, which will run anyway when the user logs in.
Just left-clicked on the top, no, yep. Left-click on this.
Yes?
Yes, properties.
Okay, GP update. You see that the policies has been updated. Now I start again Collabora Office, and let's see what happened. Here in the security options, I can see the when creating PDF files checkbox is checked, and there is the key beside the checkbox which shows that this setting is logged. Okay, so it works. So as you can see, we have quite a few options here that we can set centrally. However, feel free, everyone, to suggest new settings or send patches to this ADMX file or send localizations. We have French and Italian localizations so far. And thanks to Marina Latini, from today, we can even use PO files to translate this ADMX template. So it's even easier than to edit the XML. So as you see, for each setting, there is a little description and the usually the string from the UI is copied there. So it's easy to translate from with the LibreOffice translation memory. Okay. And finally, I'd like to talk a little bit about the issues with this. So it's not everything as nice as it could be. And I suggested easy hacks to improve the LibreOffice user interface. The problem is that when we lock down a setting in the central configuration management solution, it would be nice if the user couldn't modify it, and it would be nice if the user could see that the setting is actually logged, so they wouldn't try. So I have five cases. The first case, when we have the UI element disabled, it's great, and there is a little key icon next to the element, which shows that we locked the setting. So this is the ideal case. This is what we put into the marketing materials, and this is what I presented you in this little demo. The second case, when the element is disabled, however, the user has no idea why, what happened. They cannot edit it, but the lock icon is not there. Well, it's still acceptable, but would be better. We also have cases when the user can edit, actually, the lockdown value. However, it has no effect. It's also good. We can accept this result, but it would be better if they couldn't edit, because they have the feeling that they changed something, but actually they didn't. Okay, there are also cases, unfortunately, where the user can effectively override the lockdown value. This is a problem. Unfortunately, there is no recipe for find all of these cases, so we need to find them one by one, and of course, I'd like to receive bug reports, because there are so many settings in the, on the UI. I can go through all of them. And the first case, when the user changes the setting and when presses the OK button, LibreOffice crashes, because the underlying configuration manager detects that the user tried to write the read-only configuration value, and then assertion is failed. Yesterday I fixed one more case, so there is some progress, and so when we find these cases, we can quite easily fix them, but I need help from the community to find these cases, because every panel, every configuration dialog follows a different method, let me say. So they are use a different naming convention and different way to read the settings. There is one modern recommended way to do the things, and there is an easy hack for that. I show the bug number. However, still there are a lot of cases when the old code with some ad hoc solution doesn't take into account that configuration values can be actually locked down. So that is my last slide, the call for action. This is what we need to do to improve the situation. So the framework is there, but LibreOffice UI is not always capable of handling the situation. So thanks for your attention. If you have any questions, please.